experience, what are you measuring? Does that include delays, cancellations, reimbursement? What are people happy about? Because it includes those things. I'm not in the sense that people will be happy. So what are you actually measuring in terms of patient satisfaction?
So first thing to say is that the measurements are done independently of us by transport providers. So they set the methodology, but we then mirror exactly their studies and do it much more frequently and do it also regularly so we know what's going on better than they do. They measure everything, so passenger satisfaction with everything from the staff that they deal with at stations on trains, customer service, colleagues, the availability of parking, the information that they're provided during disruption, the cost of their tickets, every component.
And they're very happy with all of that?
Well, no, so there are a number of things where we focused on, we have made significant improvements. So okay. I have got a few stats just to give you an illustration from the last wave. So satisfaction with the environment at our stations went up 16% points in the last wave. Satisfaction with punctuality and reliability went up 15% points at the last stage. And satisfaction with the availability of our staff at stations went up by 13% as well.
Where do you need to make improvements? Where do you need to make improvements for this survey?
So I think one of the lowest scores that we've got is availability of Wi-Fi on our trains. So only 18% of passengers are satisfied with the availability of Wi-Fi, which is I suppose good because at the moment there isn't any Wi-Fi on our trains. the even better news for the remaining 18% of passengers is that there will be very soon. So in a matter of weeks, we're planning to make an announcement and to turn on Wi-Fi on the majority of the trains on our fleet. We've been fitting the equipment for well over a year. We didn't want to turn it on too early, but only one train in 20 might have it. And then we'll complete the rollout of that equipment such that all of our trains will have Wi-Fi in a matter of months. So that's one of the key things we need to improve. But clearly there are a whole range of areas where we want to make improvements over the course of next year.
Okay. Can I come back up to the
please? Thank you, Chair. I wondered whether the next upgrade, whether you or someone else will have new rolling stock, because I understand some of the reliability problems are to do with the rolling stock now, with sort of trains breaking down, and carriages, problems with carriages, and it's sometimes difficult to get them off. So I wondered whether the rolling stock is likely to be updated.
So I suppose I can answer that question in two parts quickly. I can't comment on whether a rolling stock is going to be updated, because ultimately that'll be a matter for the bidders to say this is what we will offer and have it. But there's no denying that some of our trains at the moment are approaching the end of their design lives. And you're quite right that has an impact on their reliability. So for example, the class 465 trains that we operate in the network of fleets, are getting to be, they're about 25 years old or so, and we've changed the maintenance regime of that fleet so that we've got more time available to do the longer, more tricky bits of maintenance than needed for older trains. So we've proactively changed the way we're maintaining them. One of the issues that is behind reliability problems on that particular fleet has in the last year or so been to do with a bit of electrical equipment that is part of the door system, which is its life has expired on some of those trains sooner than the rest of the train. So we've had to go through a programme of sourcing a piece of kit which was made, which was high tech 25 years ago, but maybe it's now and able to reach out to all of those trains. Some of that has been compounded by the fact that to address some of the capacity challenges we've got, we've run our trains further than we usually. So over the last year, they've done 700,000 extra miles than they would normally, and that's obviously extra wear and tear. So you know, we're trying to balance keeping those trains running, but at the same time putting as many of them into traffic as the terminology goes as possible so that people can actually use them.
I had a quick one, which was just that since I saw you last week, I've had a couple of residents complain about the process of delaying repay and sort of how the difficulty of doing it, and that you have to wait 30 minutes. You have to be delayed 30 minutes. Would this be something Southeastern would be willing to look at in terms of making it easier for one and two, potentially a shorter time than 30 minutes. And then just my second point was, following on from our conversation last week, just so more people know what's being done by Southeastern to address the niggles that there have been since the turn of the year and opening of London Bridge.
So on the overhead pay, I suppose there is some very positive news for those passengers who are delayed and who won't be near future, because after the published minimum specification for the next franchise is a change for that 30-minute threshold to be reduced to 15 minutes. So from April 2019, when the successful bid for the next franchise takes over, that will change. The reason we have a 30-minute effectively is driven by the change in government policy. As you're probably aware, we are running a government contract to run with a contractual period of time in that contract. It's better part of that 30-minute day repay scheme is something we should offer. We completely acknowledge that it can be a bit tricky for passengers to claim compensation when trains are delayed, particularly for those passengers who are travelling not with kind of classic train paper tickets. We've tried very hard to make the process as simple as possible. We've made sure our web forms are as thick as they can be. Ultimately, we need to make sure that the trains that people are on were actually delayed. We've really tried not to make that too onerous. I think the key thing I want to say is that we genuinely want to encourage passengers to apply for that compensation if their trains have been delayed, and have significantly increased the amount of compensation we're paying, not because there's more to be paid, but because we've been making more announcements on trains, both through conductors on those services that have them, or through for our drivers, wherever we have significant delays, to make sure that people are aware of their rights and how to go about claiming compensation for trains that have been delayed. And we're continuing to do that as part of an industry programme to increase the awareness and ease of claiming compensation where people are before.
I'm just interested, how is that reimbursement made now? I mean, what's the difficulties? What's the problem?
In what sense, sorry?
Well, you said you were trying to make it easier for people to get repaid when in terms of the delay. So trying to figure out what the problem is.
So the challenge is not so much paying people, because there's a huge range of ways that we can give people a compensation. There are 9 different ways that we can pay people to give compensation. The challenge is more validating whether or not the train you were on was delayed by 30 minutes or more, which is tricky if you touch him with a contactless payment card, for example, the train that you boarded, it was one service that's very frequent from the same station. So we then need to check whether or not there were other routes that you could have taken to get to your final destination on time. So the complexity of the network and the fact that in Greater London in particular, then we'll be able to do it pretty soon, means that there's the validation work up front, which is a bit tricky.
It could take, a couple of weeks?
Oh, no, much quicker than that. The turnaround time, I think, is 10 days. I can confirm that previously. But it's certainly not that.
I'm conscious of the time. I think any further questions could be written, if I may suggest it. But before, gentlemen, leave the table, I do want to share with you what I think is the best ever announcement I will ever have heard, and more correctly seen, and I don't think it can ever be surpassed. I don't know which of you looks after the dot matrix and which of you looks after the announcements themselves, but you will recall in the run up to Christmas the warnings which were put out about the closure of the London Bridge and how you put them on the dot matrix saying, you know, whatever it was, etc. Well, on this occasion, the dot matrix repeated the announcement that had been made for a particular train at Charlton Station and had just replaced the bit saying the London Bridge will be closed and left the rest of it there. And it came out on the dot matrix is, the train on the platform has no working toilets. Please be ready with your plan B. Absolutely true.
Not plan B.
I'll leave that one with you. Thank you very much for your time tonight and for your help with us in preparation for this evening as well as